Jalil Farooq has committed to the University of Oklahoma. We got to talk about it after the bumper.
Don't be cornering me. Hold up. Time. You got to help me with that corner shit.
What's up, kinfolk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step mill. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. It's always college football related, sports related. We have a good time today. Oklahoma gets some much needed good news as the number 23 wide receiver in the 247 sports composite, Jalil Farooq, has chosen to commit to the University of Oklahoma. This is great following a tremendously bad loss to Kansas State, 38-35. But Farooq joins an already good 2021 recruiting class, if not bordering on getting too great. This is also a very close friend of Caleb Williams, who was five-star quarterback commit to Oklahoma and has been very, very aggressive in pursuing targets to join him in this class, even going to other high school football players' games outside the state when possible to recruit them to the fold. And Farooq was one of those players that needed to join Williams. He was on hand at Williams' announcement on July 4th. He has been in close contact with him for some time, and he gives him not just another weapon to help him in the future for this Oklahoma Sooners program, gives him a person that he has some tremendous chemistry with already, and you already love the idea of a quarterback and a wide receiver being on the same page together a year out of being on the same field together in college. Brian Doan gives us the breakdown on Farooq at 247 Sports. Give him a follow at Brian Doan 247. Farooq is a dynamic athlete who had a choice on which side of the ball he wanted to play in college. Clemson was one of those schools recruiting him to play cornerback, but Farooq wanted to play offense, and it's easy to see why. 22 touchdowns, 1,400 yards receiving, 96 touches as a junior. Well, not receiving, but all-purpose, excuse me. The film analysis shows a guy that's got tremendous footwork as a defensive back and great instincts as a defensive back, and you gotta love how that can transfer to wide receiver because you have a built-in advantage, wide receiver. You know the snap count, you know where you're going, you know where the ball's going to be. As a defensive back, you don't have any of those challenges, right? Or you don't have any of those advantages. You are presented with those challenges. And with Farooq, we also need to talk about him as a guy that can get off the line of scrimmage. Like, that's what is going to separate him in college. Matter of fact, here's Doan. He is tough to jam on that line of scrimmage with his release. When his release is clean, he gets to full speed within a few steps. He has body control to get to his breaks at the rate of high speed, and he's fearless in traffic and high points the ball downfield. Like, this is what you want in a OU wide receiver coming out of Upper Marlboro in Maryland. Again, four-star in the composite, number 133 in the 247 sports composite, and 169 in the top 247. He's joining a class that stays at number 14 in the rankings, which is where I thought they should be. Last year, Oklahoma finished at number 12. The next year, they're already sitting there at like number 9. The highest rated class that Oklahoma's had in the Lincoln Riley era is 6. That's the 2019 class. He joins wide receivers like Mario Williams and is going to give you another target, right? For a dude that moves around very well, who's got a laser for an arm and is a charismatic leader. He was already kind of teasing this up, saying in his Monday SI blog that he was going to be very excited about it. Cody Jackson, also the first dude to commit to this 2021 class, is included. Got to talk about what they're going to be able to go up against as well. Guys like Latrell McCutcheon, who's one of the better cornerbacks in this 2021 class. You add to that Caleb Johnson, what he could be on that side of the ball. Damon Harmon, what he could be on that side of the ball. Jordan Mooks and what he could be on that side of the ball. I mean, all of a sudden, you got a really great 7-on-7 team, which is what you would expect at Oklahoma, all things considered. But I can't underscore what the chemistry is going to be for these two. And as Riley continues to try to recruit players to Oklahoma, it's important to underscore commitments mean so much more and so much less. I'll unpack that here in just a second in this age because the dead period is extended through December 31st, which is to say that you don't have the official visits to use to woo players this season. They're out the window. You only have virtual visits. You only have dead period recruiting tactics, which is written response and FaceTime conversations and Zoom and text and Twitter. If you got to play mobile games with the guys to get to know them, then you need to do that. Because the ways in which coaches traditionally recruit players, pounding the pavement, getting in the car, making the drive, getting to know the coaches, getting to know the families, doing the in-home visits, are gone. So those commitments that you have to work harder to stay on top of, but also they're the kind that might stick through early signing period, which for now is still going to happen in December. I'd be interested to see if that gets pushed back or nixed altogether for the February National Signing Day so that perhaps in the new year we can see more visits. But this is a really great move for Lincoln Riley and a team that's going to need all the help that it can get coming in 2021 in a way that I did not think it was going to need help before Kansas State. So maybe I'm getting just a little premature on that, but getting more players in that can compete for jobs makes you better, right? The thing about this Oklahoma squad right now is that it's tremendously young at the skill positions. True freshman tailback Seth McGowan is the leading rusher. You have a redshirt freshman at quarterback in Spencer Rattler. You're asking a lot of sophomores like Theo Weiss, and you're asking a lot of Marvin Mims, who's a true freshman and has the potential to be an absolute star. But you got to grow up a little bit. And in growing up, you need those guys to be able to compete against other players that are their caliber of good. The one thing that we can say for certain about college football is that you are as good as the bottom of your depth chart. If those guys can challenge your skill, your starters, you're going to be really great. This is why Alabama, year in and year out, is an easy bet. Clemson, the last 10 years, has been an easy bet. It's one of the reasons why, looking at LSU, you can understand the fall-off. You can understand the drop-off. You lost 34 players. You lost a bunch of upperclassmen. You lost 14 players to the NFL draft alone. And then, you know, when Jamar Chase chooses to opt out, you're left with Terrace Marshall having to lead a very young wide receiving core that was really competing with those guys last year to make them as good as they have become. Now, I did not expect for Oklahoma to get this kind of good news following the loss to Kansas State, right? Because we're seeing, this is the time of year when it feels like you got to hold it all together because it can all fall apart. And getting a guy like Farooq in at this time, in this way, at this juncture, is not going to be small. It's going to loom large. And I think as we continue to watch how this Oklahoma team plays and how the coaches feel about themselves, you'll see how that bears out. All right. That is it for me. Deuces.